Tonfa, Okinawan weapon. It's supposed to be for grinding sticks. Often done with karate kata, so that where you'd have punches, you'd use these to strike and then you flick out to hit. Yeah? And you can also use them like hooking weapons, breaking, striking, punching, yeah? Hitting inwards, using these points, hitting inwards like that. So these are like augmented blocking, yeah? Blocking, striking, striking. So if you like these sort of things, you can do all your katas with these, tomfa, old Okinawan weapon. Chinese as well, prior to that. Sai, for use against these swords. You know, perhaps poorer people, not allowed to carry swords. Maybe you'd have these hidden up your gi. They'd often carry these in threes, and they'd use one to throw and trap somebody into a tree or into the floor. You know, throw this into the floor and trap your ankle with a barb. Yeah? So one would be used as a throwing weapon, and then these would be used like this. So when they block, the steel of the sword is hitting on the hedge of ear. I've done a demo with my sensei, you know, full-on sword attack against Sai. He was using the Sai. These are used like this, you know. You've probably seen them all in the modern films, you know. Fancy Sai work, great karate weapons. Make sure you do your basics proper, because you stab yourself otherwise if you've got sloppy basics, yeah? So you've got to have nice, precise basics for using Sai, yeah? And like I said, I'm not proficient with these. You really need to get somebody's handy at them and have a little demo. It's very nice to see. But them are Sai. Probably again Chinese originally, but often considered a Okinawan. Shinai. These are good for hitting students with. Oh, you'll be yourself, won't you? In the old days, they'd smack people with these. Sounds great, doesn't it? They don't really hurt. Just a bit of a knock. They use them in kendo, yeah? But there's a form of Zazen meditation, whereas if you're not quite concentrating, they'll come round and hit you with a stick, you know, so that you do your meditation proper, the old style. So that's a shinai made out of bamboo. It's a bit shot out, this one, but it'll give you an idea. And they practice kendo with it, you know, with the masks, so you can practice your sword cuts. Now, great for martial artists, just doing 1,000 cuts. So this would be 1,000 cuts, you know, you do 1,000 cuts like this. Great arm training. You know, you can do it with a shinai or whatever. This is a bokken. Brilliant weapon. This is every bit as good as a sword. If you took me on with one of them swords, I'd probably win with this. Because you'd only need one shot, but I'd only need one shot. You heard of Miyamoto Musashi? Book of Five Rings? Anybody? You should read the book. He used a sword that was cut out of an oar. You know, rowing boat oar. So it would probably have been very much like this, heavy weapon. And he used to take on famous swordsmen with a piece of wood and kill them. One strike. And he did it, really, as a form of contempt. It's like, you've got a posh sword, I've got a piece of wood, I'm going to kill you with a piece of wood. He's contemptuous, yeah? And that was part of his psychology of fighting. But I suggest you read the Gōrin no Shō, Book of Five Rings. It's a classic martial arts work. That's a bokken. This, I believe, is very interesting and very, very rare. This is a kamikaze pilot's sword. Kamikaze, you know, suicide squadrons, the guys who used to dive bomb the ships in the Second World War, Pacific. And this was a reserve kamikaze pilot. So he was in reserve, about to fly his plane into an American ship. But he surrendered. So this was, it's meant to be about 300 years old, so it's a family sword he would have taken to war with him. Yeah? And this was surrendered to Commander Sharpie Schaefer, Royal Navy, skipper of HMAS Shepparton, at the Japanese surrender on Bougainville Island. The sword belonged to a reserve kamikaze lieutenant whose name is on the canvas label. Well, you can just about see it on there. That's his name. It's a lovely sword. Can you see the, I just move it, you can probably see the hound's tooth in the steel. Now if you want to have a look at these, you can come and have a look later. You'll see the hound's tooth in steel if you hold it to the light. But please don't touch the blades and be very careful with them. This is probably worth £2,000 or £3,000, this one blade. This is what most of the stuff would look like coming back from the war. This is a war-mounted Japanese blade. They would have looked in this sort of condition. This is what's known as a wakizashi. There's a little holder there. It's been repaired a couple of times, if you look along the blade. This is in standard military mounts, so this is how it would have been done during the war. Sometimes the blade was an old family blade that they had remounted. But that's pretty much what they looked like after the Second World War. This is what I've cleaned up and done up a little bit because it was in such bad state. This would have been maybe a general sword or a high-ranking officer's sword. Can you see that it's got a bullet hole in the scabbard? There. It's probably the bullet hole, part of the round of bullets that killed the guy. It was found lying in the jungle in Burma at a place called Kohima, where there was a great battle, Battle of Kohima. If you know your Second World War stuff, that's from Kohima. Again, you found quite a lot of these. Can you see it's a bit beefier blade? Quite a thing. They charge the enemy with these things, with the commander in the front often shouting Banzai. Yeah? So that would be that one. This would be an NCO's blade, you know, like a lower ranking officer. Again, it's been done up a little bit. This apparently had quite a nasty, this is what they call a warrant officer's sword. It was made in Germany, believe it or not, a place called Solingen. But that's quite a nice finish on it. It's probably been polished up over here. They didn't often look quite so good during the war. But I believe this one was a particularly nasty history and was used for beheadings, probably, unfortunately, against our troops. But that's war for you. A wakizashi. Wakizashi means young sword. The short swords, often they carry two swords, a short one and a long one. The idea of the long one was for killing outside. The idea of the short sword was for indoor combat. And so people like Musashi would sometimes use a sword in each hand. Again, Smith forged blade, you can see the different steels in it. Very, very old. I'm not quite sure how old, but we've got an idea, 1550 on here. Old blade, 500 years old. Yeah. Wakizashi again, quite a nice one with nice mounts on it. These things alone can be worth a couple of hundred quids. Just the bits on there, they were made out of gold, various irons. The Subas can be worth 200 or 300 quid. Beautiful lacquer work on the scabbard. Interesting on this one, it's flat on this edge and got a couple of different cut lines on the other edge, so it's obviously been reworked at some point. And then the final one that always gives me a rather strange feeling is this one. Again, it's a wakizashi, short sword. But this one's been used in sword combat. If you look towards the end there, can you see the nick? In the end, that's where another sword has sliced down on the top of it at a fairly heavy belt and left a sword nick in there. So this has been used in hand-to-hand sword combat, for real. And the way that's been chopped into, it looks like they were going at it a bit. And when I hold on to this sword, it gives me a real strange feeling. So, I don't know, I think this has probably got quite a history. But all you can do is imagine. Okay, got any questions?